both make comics, and we both use Inkscape to do our comics.
Yeah. And we've each sort of settled on our own workflow for doing comics. And really, especially when you're working as an individual artist, workflow ends up being fairly personalized. So for the sake of the talk, we're going to be using the sort of traditional comic creation workflow that you'll see in the big comic studios, especially back in the day when before they were doing digital. That's still the point of reference for modern digital workflows today. So, and pretty much the way that the big comic studios would do it, and still do it, is pretty much an assembly approach. They basically have a whole bunch of artists, each one whose job is to do a specific step of the process. You would have pencilers who pretty much just would draw in pencil the each page on a fairly large sheet of stiff paper. And usually they'd be doing that in non-color blue, so it wouldn't show up later in the process. The actual line art that you would see in the comic would be done by the next guy in line, the inker, who would basically go over those pencils in pen. And while the guy's doing that, he's not a tracer. He's making editorial decisions. Sometimes he's fixing mistakes the pencilers made. Less experienced pencilers might skip shading altogether and leave that to the inker to do.
And if you ever need an inker, don't call him a tracer, because they'll get very, very angry at you.
And once the page had been inked on this sheet of paper, they would typically make a copy of it. And one copy would be sent off to an artist known as the colorist, who would apply colors to that. And then there would be actually a separate artist just to do the letter in the set of dialogue and so forth. And pretty much all the lettering, the inker might have done some, like the sound effects and that kind of thing. But once you have the colorists and the letterers doing their thing, then there'd be a final step where their work would be combined either using transparent overlays or actually cutting and pasting, literally, to prepare something that could be photographed and turned into printing plates. And these days, the process in a major comic studio still works much the same way, except that the process is digital, using programs that are probably familiar to most graphic artists. Typically, the pencils will end up, they're still often done physically and then scanned into Photoshop. And then often inking is done in Photoshop, as well as coloring. Sometimes painters also use. Lettering usually happens in Adobe Illustrator. And the equivalent of paste up, where the whole mess is combined together, the vector lettering on top of the bitmap colors, happens in a page layout program like Dark Express or InDesign, and then that goes digitally to print. Of course, nowadays, most of these programs have open source equivalents. So if one wanted to reproduce the digital workflow of a major comic studio with open source software, it is at least in principle possible to do so. But at this point, most of the folks using them are really indie comic artists like ourselves. And for us, where we have one or two people working on a comic, the workflow is going to be different in terms of we're probably going to be combining steps. I usually, for my comic, both our comics, we're really doing all of the steps ourselves and just cutting it the way we like. Another, especially when you're doing it as individual, it's still a lot of work. And so automation also becomes really important. We're going to talk a little bit about what we do in terms of automation, but most of this talk is going to be about how we work in Inkscape to do our comics. And so first of all, John's going to talk a little bit about the scanning stage, which is still best done in, again, as it's a bitmap this part of the process is good enough. So I'll let cover that.
All right. So we both use Xstain to do our scanning, making sure that the Xstain plugin for Begin is installed, new scanners all detected and everything. You would go and start Xstain within the GIMP. You get your nice Xstain display. Now, Methyl draws on letter size paper, 8.5 by 11. And in the US, that's the typical scanner size. So his sheets of paper fit perfectly onto a scanner and can be scanned in one piece. Makes it really easy to import the file, save it out, and get it ready to be placed in Inkscape. I, on the other hand, draw a much larger sheet of paper. I draw on 11 by 14, add an 8.25 by 13 inch drawing area. That size is significantly larger than a letter size, so this sheet of paper doesn't fit completely on my scanner in one scan. So for this, I have to scan my comic page in two parts, and it's going to be rotated when I scan the top and the bottom. So I have to go ahead and rotate both of these pieces so that they're both upright. The next step, I have to take the top piece, and I have to make it larger so that it can accommodate the bottom piece underneath of it. So for there, I go to image canvas size, and I'm going to resize this page. Now, the page needs to be 8.25 by 13. So that my comic will fit on it. So with the image size dialog up, I uncheck the chain icon and I make the height 14.5 inches. Now, for those of you who don't know, the chain icon allows you to adjust the width and the height independently of each other. Controls the aspect ratio of the image. So I made my page approximately 9 inches wide by 14.5. And I have this nice transparent area underneath waiting for the bottom piece. Now, this is a neat little trick in the GIMP. I don't know how many people know how to do this, but you select an image that you want to drag onto another image. Open up the layers dialog if it's not already open, and arrange the top image and the layers dialog so they're sitting next to each other. Then select the bottom piece. Grab the background layer and drag it over to the top piece, and suddenly you've got the two pieces merged together. You can copy and paste a whole bunch of different ways to do it. I find this to be the fastest. Then you would use the move tool, zoom in pretty close to the edge where the two pieces are going to meet, and you're going to drag the bottom piece so it lines up approximately with the top piece. It doesn't have to be perfect, because any sort of pieces that don't fit properly, you can always fix when you're in Inkscape. Once you've got everything lined up properly, you're going to want to do a couple of additional steps. You're going to want to crop, you're going to want to merge all the layers together so that it's all in one layer. You want to crop the image so that you don't have any extra transparency bits or any too much of your page. And then Xstain does a pretty good job of adjusting the levels when you scan it in. If you need to adjust a little bit yourself, go ahead and do that. And then you go to the file menu and choose save as. I save my images as PNG files, you can save them as JPEG. Of course, the difference is glossy versus lossless. It really doesn't matter a whole lot, it's whatever you're more comfortable with. If you're going to save it for Inkscape purposes, I just uncheck all these extra options and pump the compression level all the way up. I save my image, and then I close both images in the GIMP. It's going to ask if you want to save the bottom piece. Don't worry about it, it's already taken care of. Now we're going to move on to inking.
And of course, Inkscape proper. Now that we've got the pencils scanned, the next thing we want to do is get them into Inkscape and set up our Inkscape documents so that it's relatively easy to find a set of trace ink over top of them. The first thing you want to pay attention to is the page setup. You want to make sure that you have the page background. That is going to make a big difference once you export the page from Inkscape as, say, a PNG later on in the process. You definitely want to have the page border showing, and you want to show the border on top of the drawing, because once you import that big penciled image, it's going to cover up the page, and you're going to need to see where it falls in relation to the page border to actually get the size right. In this case, since you've got to have a piece of paper,
Get one.
The, since the format of my comic is 5.5 by 8.5 inches, which is half of the letter size. Thank you. Yeah. You basically, it's half the letter size, hold it over like that. And that's the particular format that I use for my name.
It's called digest size.
Thank you. That was the thing. Anyway, the next thing I do is set up the layer for the pencils to live on. I just rename the default layer of the pencils. I turn the opacity way down so the pencils layers can be grayed out. That makes it a lot easier to see what I'm doing when I'm inking over the top and make sure I don't miss any spots. Because sometimes a really dark pencil is going to look too much like it's not working. The next thing is use file import. Import that PNG that you saved from the div. And this is pretty much what you ended up at that point. You notice that it's ended up much larger than the actual page size here. So the first thing you do is use zoom it to drawing so you can fit everything you've got in your document on screen. And then use the selection tool to resize your pencils to fit the actual page that you're going to be making. And then you can zoom back in. The next thing I do is create a separate layer to do the actual inking on. And at this point, I also lock the pencils so I don't end up accidentally grabbing with the pencils and moving them around on myself. Really full house here. So, generally, what I do next is I start by inking the panels. And it usually works best so the panels are neatly aligned and have a look consistent is to actually set up a grid and do the panel borders over the grid. So generally, you're going to want to make the size, the spacing of the grid a factor of the overall page size. In this case, I typically use a grid size of 1/16 of an inch, which is 0.0625. Inkscape, when displaying, will round off the spacing to two significant digits, but I actually did type 0.625 in there, and it does remember that. And so, with the grid shown, I just plop down my panels over it, lining up as best I can with what I did in the pencils, but obviously, that can exercise some interpretation and judgment in lining that up. A lot of comic artists put more space vertically between the panels than they do horizontally. That's a matter of convention, and sometimes it helps readability, but there's nothing really requiring to do that. And then the next part of me, once I got the panel borders laid out and sort of committed to how they're going to be situated, I go to the calligraphy tool to do the actual inking. And I have to say, the calligraphy tool is probably, personally, I think it's the best part of the Inkscape. Bulliet has a lot to do with that. He's spent a lot of time working on various aspects of the tool. It's a lot better. And one of the things, at least for this, what I do, I found it's best to set the calligraphy tool to use its width in absolute units. Because I tend to zoom in and out a lot when I'm working, and that's the only way to get a really consistent line with as I'm doing that. And as far as the actual settings that go with the calligraphy tool, typically go with a width of about 5 pixels for that page size that I'm using, but you're going to have to find what works for you. I use a little bit of thinning, not much. I turn fixation all the way to 0, so, and turn caps up near 1.0. And those two settings basically give me the illusion of a round pen. And then the rest of the settings, which do some very interesting and unusual things, but I don't really want interesting and unusual when I'm just trying to ink a line. So I leave those near 0. And of course, I like to turn pressure sensitivity. So here's the page ready to be inked. I usually zoom in, and I typically start inking faces. there's no real reason to do that. I just like to start that way. And from there, I work on the areas around, outline the areas that I'll be coloring in later. And typically, I often just scribble in the areas like I would with a pen. Occasionally, I'll use other methods to fill, but since I'm not actually coloring my pages, my comics are usually black and white. I don't have to worry about that so much. John's going to talk a little bit about what you want to do for color comics and filling in color areas that don't match the color of the comics. And one of the things here, I really don't like the way that I came out. And right now we're about to get to one of the real advantages of inking using a vector program versus a bitmap program, which is bitmaps are more traditional, but there are a lot of advantages to doing it the vector way. And so one of them is that each individual stroke that you've made with the calligraphy pen exists as a separate object and retains its own identity. If this were a bitmap tool, and I wanted to fix that up, this part of the stroke would be lost out here at this point. And I would basically just have to erase up to the hairline and redraw it from scratch. But since it still exists with its own identity as a vector object, I can just use the selection tool and move these guys around to get more what I was going for in the first place. In a similar way, I can also edit, rather than just moving stuff around, I can also head into the Note tool and adjust the make slight adjustments to the stroke to get it more the way I wanted it. Really, it's best to just draw it right the first time. If it's really off, don't bother tweaking it, just erase it and redraw. But a lot of the time, you're going to have it close, but not quite. And in those cases, it's going to be a lot faster and save you a lot of work if you can just tweak it just a little bit. And vectors let you do that without disturbing all of the other lines around it. And that is a big advantage in itself.
Do you ever use the Simplify tool to simplify the lines?
I typically don't. John does.
Yeah. I'll do my inking, and before I do any adjustments, I'll simplify every path.
I have another question. Mm-hmm. When you're filling in an area by scribbling, how do you get it so that it's its own area and it's not like tons of lines everywhere?
Well, again, I typically don't. John would.
Outset and inset.
Outset and inset?
Yeah, just
do
that.
Or you can just do a union on the path with it itself, and that will flatten it in just an area. I tend to be a little bit cavalier about how complex my paths are because usually it's getting taken. But yeah, it's better to simplify. It's not been a problem for me, so I tend to do it. Your mileage will vary. Now, John's going to talk a little bit about color.
All right. My first book was in black and white, so I really didn't worry a whole lot about coloring, but this latest webcomic I'm doing is in color. And so I took on the added challenge of using Inkscape to do full color webcomic. Now, the first way that I started coloring was using the pen tool to create polygons and designate curves. So I'm going to use this page as an example, and I'm going to use this area as the part that I'm going to color with this character Kimberly snapping her finger. Now, using the pen tool, and using any coloring technique, I would create a new layer called colors underneath of the inks layer. And I would color on that, that way my inks stay on top of the colored areas. So using the pen tool, I have her skin color selected and I tap, and I would create a path. Now, average page has maybe about 250, 500, maybe even up to 1,000 of these areas that I have to color. After about 35 or 40 pages of doing this, I get really angry. And so one weekend, with the help of several other Inkscape developers who are here, put together the paint bucket tool. The paint bucket tool works just like you would imagine it would in the GIMP. You would select your color that you want to fill, and you click inside of the area, and it will create a fill color path. This cuts down the coloring time for each page from about 8 hours to 2, which of course means there's more time for beer. Now, there are also other coloring techniques like special effects. Gouge and blur has been an incredible addition to the Inkscape, and I use it for doing shading of my characters' faces. I'll make a shading layer above the colors layer, but underneath the inks layer. And let's say I wanted to shade Kimberly's face over here, so she's got a nice shade right underneath of her jaw. What I'll do is I'll use the pen tool, and I will create a transparent polygon, black. Maybe that's 30% transparent. Now I'll pump blur a little bit, so I have this nice smooth gradient along where her chin is. I'm then going to draw another path, highlighting the areas I want to keep. Doesn't matter what color it is. I'm going to select both of these paths, and then I'm going to do object clip set. I'm going to set a clipping path for those two paths, which means it will keep whatever I've drawn on top. Now I've got a nice smooth shade that only covers her face. Now, there are limits to Paint Bucket and the blur in Inkscape. The first one is, the Paint Bucket is a visual tool, it's not geometric. It does not do any mathematical comparisons to see the perfect path that needs to go in there. It's going to do what the GIMP does. It's going to render what you have, paint bucket it using a standard bucket fill algorithm, and then trace whatever it finds. Which means sometimes you'll get little gaps like that. One good thing about Paint Bucket is that the closer you zoom in, the higher resolution your fill. But you still get little gaps like that. One way is to fix it with the node tool. The other way is to zoom in even farther, hold down the shift key to click, and then click in the area you want to fill. And this works with any fill. It will join the new fill with whatever you had selected before, which will fill in everything. There's also a couple of other additional settings to the Paint Bucket tool that will help reduce these errors. One of them is threshold, and the other one is gross shrink. Now, threshold works the same as the GIMP. Let's say the color you click on with the Paint Bucket tool is white, and then you've got a black circle surrounding that. Well, the black circle is going to have a little bit of a fuzzy edge to it because of anti-aliasing. There's going to be some grays and those sorts of things in there. Turning up threshold increases the amount of fuzziness you'll accept for that fill algorithm to go into. So, if you click on a white area and you've got a light gray area and your threshold's fairly high, it'll fill in the light gray area too. That takes some experimentation, depends on how what you're filling in and what technique you're using for creating your areas. The other one is gross shrink. This works just like inset and outset. I'm going to fill that red path over there with blue. So I'm going to click on it, and if my gross shrink by is positive, this is positive half a pixel, the area that I'm filling will get larger. Now, if you're doing it, what I'm doing with an ink layer on top, that will make the path fill to be perfectly underneath of the inks. One other thing you can do is set gross shrink by the negative. When you click in that area, the path will be smaller. The other limitation is that blur isn't yet supported by PDF or EPS output. If you use blur in a document, you're going to have to export it as a PNG file. And so we're on to lettering.
Yes. Okay. Lettering and balloons. A lot of folks actually do their balloons at the inking stage. That's not always done. There's some people who actually put off doing any kind of lettering or balloon decisions until long after they've done the rest of the artwork. I personally don't think it's a good idea to get into why later on. Here's the page all inked and everything, and ready for the lettering balloons to be added. Typically what I do myself is I go back to the script and pencils and just write out the text using the text tool in the margins alongside the panels where they're going to go. At that point, I can use the ellipse tool and draw ellipses and put that text over top, do any reformatting that might be necessary. And we've got our basic balloon set up here. really important to plan ahead with your lettering and your balloons. While I left the balloons out of the inking stage, if you look, I did actually make my basic decisions about where the balloons go in my pencils, because otherwise it's very easy to paint yourself into a corner and like have all this text and no place to put it. Or you end up having to put it someplace that's confusing. The person needs to read here, and then there's some text over here that we need to jump to. Ideally, you really want to be making the text part of your visual flow. Comics are about words and text and pictures together. They're common to one another, so it's really best to make those decisions up front. Now, the next thing, of course, is we've got these ovals, but they don't look quite like a professional balloon, and we also need to put little tails on them, for the sake of who's talking, usually. And typically, what I'll do is I'll just drop into the note tool here, and right now that's still an ellipse, but I use the convert path to turn this ellipse into a path with four nodes. And then I can just go around each one of those nodes, select it, and use the arrow keys to bump it in, usually about two or three times. And just continue all the way around. And that gives us the more traditional, and usually more professional looking, flattened oval balloon book. The other part of the equation is the tail on the balloon. And typically what you need to do there is you want to establish a couple nodes on the path to serve as the base of the tail, and then another node between them for the point of the tail. In this case, I'm just going to use this node here as one of my base nodes, and I'll just create a second node on the path there. Once I've got those two nodes created and selected, then I've kind of got a little routine that I go through. I use add node, which creates another node right in between them. I convert them to cusp nodes, because these are going to be sharp turns of the path. And then I convert them to line segments, because the balloon tail is pretty much just a straight little dagger sticking out. I don't want the curves in it. And I can just select that middle node, pull it out, and I'm pretty much done. If I want to have like a little bit of a curly tail, then I can just grab the line, pull it, and curve it how I like it. In my experience, if you are going to curve the tail, it's better to make the base a little bit wider than you would naturally do otherwise. There's the more or less finished page, as you would see it in the comment or on the website. I think I fixed that a little bit since I put that sort of check, but other than that. And now John's going to talk about exporting work from Inkscape.
All right. We're both programmers, and we like to make our lives easy. So we've both written scripts to handle exporting our SVG files into web and print-ready formats. I use Python because I wanted to learn Python, and mental use Ruby, but you can do it however way you choose. So we have our scripts, and they both do the same thing. They'll read in the directory of SVG files, pump them through Inkscape to create the appropriate bitmap output, and then we'll run them through ImageMagick to be able to process the files. Now, we process our files for two different destinations, process them for the web, and we'll process them for print. Our scripts can also generate PDF files, be they previews of the printed pages, or in Mental's case, the actual digest size, mini-size comic output for his laser printer. So you can just take those two PDF files, print the fronts, flip the pages over, print the backs, he's ready to go. But the one thing that we're missing right now is creating an actual full graphic novel. We don't have that set up yet to be able to automate that process, but we're getting there.
Right now it's pretty much a manual process of scripts.
Mm-hmm. Now the results of our Inkscape comic endeavors.
The Last Bus, which is my comic. It's a little bit hard to describe. I guess you'd probably call it, it's kind of a cross between the Twilight Zone and Mad Max. And This is what the website itself looks like. And this is pretty much generated straight from the suite of scripts that I have from the SVG files.
He does have a printed comic, not with him, but he can get one to show you. I'll show you on the screen. In Moments of Clarity is my all-ages graphic novel. I started doing this in Photoshop way back in the day, and then eventually switched to using all open-source software. I did an issue in the GIMP, and then eventually I was talked into doing an Inkscape. It's published on the web, and it's published in print, and right now I'm aiming for a second graphic novel. And my procedure for the first book, Thonis Rivas, this is the result of that. And I actually got the books done in two different places. The first place was Lulu, it was a print-on-demand print service. For that, you have to create PDF files for uploading. And then they take those PDF files, and then when someone orders the book, they'll just take the PDFs, print them out, print on a cover, glue everything together, and ship off that one copy of the book. It's really good if you don't want to have to keep stock of your own books, but it gets really expensive. So I also have a traditional printer in Virginia Beach who specializes in all-ages comic books. For him, I printed out every single page of the book on a single sheet of letter-sized paper with crop marks. Sent those off to him, and then he photographed everything and trimmed all the pages down, glued it all together, and produced about 150 of these for me. And so worked really well.
What 150 cost you?
About 800. He specializes in low print runs because he is a self-published comic book author himself, and he likes to help the community of other all-ages publishers.
And at the same time, he's amortizing his own artwork for printing. Mm-hmm. I mean, is that surprising? You say he photographs the pages instead of using traditional film generation for offset printing?
I don't know what he does.
That's actually not that unusual for comic publishers. I was helping a friend look through what the requirements would be for printing for comics. And so I went to a number of publishers and got technical specs for how they'd like to have jobs, comics submitted. A lot of them will take either the pages printed or photocopied and they re-photograph them and do them that way. Or they just want high resolution tips. A lot of times they don't actually take PDFs or other formats. I think part of the reason for that is because a lot of folks aren't set up to do print-ready PDFs, which really requires a very specific subset of PDF functionality, like PDFX or that series. So photographing the pages just works. Certainly having a high-resolution tip just works. I imagine that's why they do it, but it appears to be fairly common in the comics industry. The only exceptions are probably when you're talking about big comics publishers, when they have their whole standardized workflow. And in that case, these days, they're pretty much doing it digitally the whole way through, using something like Barker support to export a press-ready PDF at the end of the process.
Yes?
Do you ever think about putting the PDF or the Inkscape files up on your webcomic page as well as the images?
Thought about it, yeah. I may rethink about it since Firefox's SVG support is getting a lot better. The first webcomic that I tried to do, and it's really more ambitious than LastBox in terms of this full color, fancy shading, all that stuff, and I just burned out doing it, but my original plan was to have just SVG embedded in XHTML, and that would be the comic page. Firefox of that era just wasn't up to it, though. In fact, I'm pretty sure Firefox really had SVG support at the point when the time I started the project. I was assuming that would come out a lot sooner than it actually did. So I ended up going to PNGs mostly for that. And that's not something I've really rethought since then. As far as the PDFs go, I'm not a big believer in PDF except when you want to print something. So I don't think I'd do PDF for a webcomic. But since you bring it up, I have to rethink the the SVG thing. Because that would be cool to have just the SVG. Of course, that does also mean, for the sake of my readers, I should probably simplify the paths. up there.
How open is PDF now?
It's pretty open. It's pretty much all specified. Adobe keeps liking to add new stuff to it, like JavaScript, video, and all kinds of other insane things. But the base PDF, which you'd actually want to use for print purposes, is pretty well specified now. The specifications are out there.
So you can write software that generates PDFs and have to have a license?
No. Correct. Cairo, GhostScript, and...
Yeah, is it your CDIPF? No,
CDIPF.
Yeah, there's already a fair amount of open source software out there that does generate PDFs.
The license PDF, when you the specification from Adobe is freely downloadable, there is no strings attached, they retain copyright and trademark on PDF, but anybody can implement a reader or writer, there is no restriction. No, there are parts of PDF, the one for exchange for printing and PDF-A, PDF-X, that are ISO standards, and they are going towards pushing PDF itself as an ISO standard. So by the meaning of ISO standards, it will be a free and open spec according to various definitions of open standards. So PDF by itself is no longer a problem for, a few years. Like, we have a good implementation. One in PostScript, one in C++ for reading, and there are several libraries to generate. So I don't think that's the problem.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you. I've heard some stuff in PDF. More questions? Okay.
Yeah, it's a more artistic question. Is there a specific reason that you scan drawings by hand? Is that so difficult to try to do them from scratch in Inkscape?
No, it's a personal thing, really. I like the tactile thing, drawing pencil on paper. I actually, for some of my non-comic work, have started actually doing the pencil, essentially, in Inkscape. And it works surprisingly well. You just set like a really fine line to it in the calligraphy tool, and you can just sketch away. And surprisingly, even without simplifying it, the Inkscape does pretty well performance-wise. It'll eventually break down, but I've found I can sketch in it pretty freely. So I may eventually start doing my pencils electronically, but I'm not there yet, comfort-wise, for the comics.
When you lose. When you do sketching in Inkscape, do you find you have to use a tablet or do you actually need a touch screen?
Oh, tablet's fine. It does take a little bit to develop the hand-eye coordination. Mm-hmm. Anyone who's used a Cintiq, which is the monitor-tablet combination, pretty much anyone I've talked to prefers that because you don't have to worry about the hand-eye coordination thing so much. It's a lot more natural. But just the tablet works fine. Now, trying to draw with a mouse, that's kind of like trying to draw with a bar of soap.
I use a tablet PC, which is very similar.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's based on the Cintiq technology.
Lag starts to annoy you more. If you're using a tablet and a screen, lag doesn't seem to annoy you much because you can't see your pen tip and the cursor. For me, when I see that, it kind of bothers me when I'm doing it. So sometimes I actually prefer a tablet that isn't. Maybe it's a personal thing.
Yeah, but I lack personal experience with Cintiq, so, but that's, if there is a visible lag, that would get to me. So, more questions?
Since there's lots of Inkscape developers, what's the way to have the default for the docs I saw you, that the document just, you didn't have the cheesy drop shadow they turned on. I already tried to, but Booyah is kind of, oh, it looks nice. What's the way to get that, the setting that you had to be the default? Because it really bothers me.
Well, in general, if you want to set the default page settings, you just basically set up the document however you want.
I know that you can recreate all the templates and It's a government property, but the new version comes with its own.
Okay, I think you just like killed open office in the first year.
And another thing, could you guys stop using this hybrid Wilbur image that looks horrible? I think it's the Mac OS.
Yes. Yeah.
It looks horrible.
Yeah, I think it's not my favorite Wilbur, but we're trying to deal with the consistent policy thing. I'll bear that in mind for future presentations. if you actually have a specific Wilbur image that is preferred, it's SVG.
Yeah, it is. The
is it one in Tango?
No, it's in GIMP itself.
Okay. I'll try to... Okay, here we go. Show border shadow to this thing.
Yeah, exactly.
And
every time I start a new document, make this look like that, exactly like you have it.
It's in preferences XML, isn't it?
No, you just need to save it as a full template.
Yeah, for all the templates.
Yeah.
Could you guys? Have it in GIMPscape class so everybody has this decent default.
Yeah, you should have the shadow off by default. That's one thing that I always do whenever I
start. I pretty much all the artists that I've met have it like this.
So pretty much you're saying is should this
make
be a global setting rather than per document setting?
No, I mean, have this, if I install Inkscape, have it be like that.
So I don't have to do it every time
or save my own templates to fix this.
Good defaults that the everyone using Inkscape, or at least everybody
in there. Maybe we should do that then.
I did suggest that, but Bulia was very attached to having show border shadow by default.
I was not attached. It's just
right on
power tradition, nothing else.
Why don't there be just a save my defaults button in there?
Because it's a per document setting.
Yeah, but when you create a new document, you could have those defaults appear up.
Well, that's what you do if you actually save the document. You can set up the document the way you like and save that to replace the existing template. And that's pretty much the way that works. I think we could make that a little nicer to do.
I don't even know where
exactly.
Shouldn't borders be rather display options instead of document options? Because they don't appear on the final product, right? On the generated
right.
Document. So I mean, for me, that's something. It's more at that point we end up in a human interface. But I think that this should be moved towards a user option that's stored as the application's options, like in GCOM for whatever, instead of being part of the...
Yeah, that's what I was wondering about, the per document versus global preference thing. That's probably something I've talked about more offline, but that's probably something we need to look at. Because I didn't even think about it, but the fact is that I usually think about it all the time myself. So,
exactly.
Yeah, I think that's something we could do. Any more questions?
And the big argument for publishing on the web in SVG form is that quite often I've seen comics that are done in pixel form, and the text is just a little bit too blurry to read.
Mm.
Yeah. If I blow it up and make it bigger, it just makes it blur with SVG rather than half.
Right.
Yeah.
the one thing you need to think about then is how you want to get the text in there. If you have the text in there as text, chances are the reader's fonts aren't going to match yours. And so it might be running off the speech balloons and that kind of thing.
As long as it doesn't get clipped with speech balloons.
Which could happen depending on how the speech balloons are done.
Could it be possible to subset the fonts? Like, basically embedding as SVG shapes and just use that? I mean,
there's support for fonts embedded in SVG. We don't support that in Inkscape yet, but that would be one approach that would probably be a good way to do it.
You could probably also have just take your speech balloons and blow them up a little bit for the web version and keep them small and elegant.
Unfortunately, unfortunately, with comics, you don't often you're there are fairly little details you don't want to accidentally overlap. So you really want to find a solution that has the layout stay static. It's sort of the diametric opposite of designing for the web. It would be really interesting, actually, to see a comic that was designed to deal with the dynamic layout. Most artists aren't working for that. So subsetting the font when Inkscape can support that, or converting your text to paths would be another way to do that. Of course, text path is just going to get you so a lot of very large paths. So. Mm-hmm. Certainly, when a lot of times to see small details, the SVG is going to be a lot nicer. So there's another good reason to do that. Question up there.
Could you explain what's involved in subsetting the font? I'm not familiar with that.
There's a provision in the SVG specification for an actual SVG font format where you can basically define a font using a subset of SVG, where using the path statements and so forth to describe each glyph in the font, and also some basic things like kerning information and so forth. At that point, if you've got it set up, then you can use in CSS you can use a URL reference to reference that font object and use that font for the lettering, and that the font can actually be included in the SVG document.
It looks like we're out of time. We're going to have the next presentation getting here set up. So thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Nice.